Okay, good morning, Foundation Church. Yay! It is Youth Sunday, so we actually have our youth worship team that's going to be up here today. And I just have a couple of announcements as I throw it on the floor. So I'm Analia. Say, I'm going to be back in the children's area today, hanging out with kiddos. But we have a couple of things coming up. We have a men's retreat July 17th through the 20th. They're going to be hiking Resurrection Pass, and they have two spots that opened up. So if anybody wants to go spend some time out in the woods and hang out with Daniel, he's back there, and you can chat with him and get more information on that. We also have the Youth Fusion concert coming up. That is August 1st. They're going to be going up to Anchorage for that, just for the concert night. So you can talk to Pastor Roy if you're interested in doing that. If you're youth, sixth grade and up. Oh, where'd Roy go? He ran away. Sixth grade and up for that. And then children's ministry. If you are interested in helping out with our littles, we need someone to take over doing children's ministry. So we usually have littles through age five back there on Sundays. And so you can talk to Pastor Roy or me if you're interested in that. What we'd like to do is try and get a sign-up sheet where you sign up once a month or so to hang out back there and help out with that. So if that's something that you're interested in, you want to love on some babies, come chat with me or you can talk to Pastor Roy about that. And then the last one I had on the list was there's no fellowship dinner tonight, but next week we'll have fellowship dinner here at 6 p.m. And be hanging out. 5:30 p.m. Okay. Awesome. I think that was all that I had on the list, and so we're going to ask our youth worship team to come on up. Ooh, VBS is going to go first? Awesome. Okay, if you were here for VBS and you guys want to sing the Breaker Rock song and show them the cool dance that you learned, come on up and we're going to do that. We're going to do that to start with. So you guys can line up right here. Okay.
Thank you. Alrighty, good morning, Foundation Church. Let me fix the mic real quick. All right, if everybody'd like to stand as we begin our worship, and we'll go ahead and get started.
Forgive it.
never be ashamed. Never be ashamed. This poor man. Thank you.
Father, we thank you this morning that we have a reason to sing, Lord, and his name is Jesus. God, we thank you for sending your only begotten Son, Lord. The only way that we can know the Father is through the Son, and we thank you for sending him to die for us, Lord. We're forever grateful, and that should give us a reason to sing each and every morning. God, we give you all the praise, all the glory, all the honor. We thank you for our time to gather today. Lord, be with us as we seek through your word and what you'll have for us to learn, to understand, and discern by your Holy Spirit. We give you praise in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated, church. Thank you, worship team. A couple of awesome teenagers and Natalie, who's she's still a teenager, but she's not a youth technically anymore, but we'll keep her. We'll keep her around as long as we can. She goes back to school in about 6 weeks or so, so it's a little sad, but we'll keep her as long as we can. Amen. So thank you, guys. It's such a blast having VBS here last week and seeing a lot of those kiddos this morning, and some that had never even known that there was a church in the mall came to VBS, and so that was cool to get to see some new faces and some new families, and we're grateful for our team from Texas that came up to help lead that. What a blessing they've been the last 2 years. Little kids, speaking of, Miss Anna Leah just went back in the back. If you want to send your five and unders back there to hang out with her, and she's got a lesson planned, and what a great time that'll be. Speaking of kids ministry, like Anna Leah said this morning, we are in need of some volunteers. So if you love Jesus and you love kids and you wouldn't mind serving in that way, and you can pass a background check, we'd love to talk to you more about that. Daniel and I would love to visit and talk about it because we need it. I mean, our kids, we have a lot of kids in this church, and we're a growing church with families. Amen. And so we want to have something for kids to be able to plug into as well. And so it's a great need. And so we'd love to talk with you more if you're interested in that. This morning, we're going to be continuing our kingdom-focused series. And I think we're on week 9 of this series now, but we're in the book of James. And we are going to be in chapter 3 of James this morning. So before we get too far started in chapter 3 of James, let me ask you a question by a show of hands, or if you're too, you don't have to show your hands because it's such a heavy question, I'm sure. How many of you's mouth have ever gotten you in trouble? Yeah, some of you need to put up both hands and a foot or something, because our mouth can tend to get us into trouble. And James talks about it, Proverbs talks about it, all of God's word talks about this power of the tongue, right? And the ability to be able to contain it or tame the tongue is a spiritual discipline. It takes work. Some of us are better at it than others. Some of us have not learned a darn thing yet about taming the tongue. But the Holy Spirit can teach us how to tame the tongue. And James is going to give us some examples and some illustrations of what it looks like when we don't. What can happen? The fallout, and it can be a mess. So we're going to be in James chapter 3 this morning. I'm in the CSB if you want to follow along. If you're not, that's fine too, but you'll figure it out as we go. So chapter 3, verse 1 of the book of James. Verse 1, not many should become teachers, my brothers, because you know that we will receive a stricter judgment. For we all stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is mature, able also to control the whole body. So let's stop here for just a second in James 1 and 2 of chapter 3. Now, James is telling us who are called to teach and preach the word of God that we are going to receive a stricter judgment. That alone should cause some of us to pause before we volunteer to lead a life group or lead a Bible study or teach children's ministry or whatever it is. Because our words matter. And our understanding of what God's word means matters. And so he says we will receive a stricter judgment. Why? Because we're held to a different standard of teaching God's word. And we want to teach it with clarity and not cause confusion, because God's not an author of confusion. We want to make sure that what we're teaching is sound biblically, right? Not just what I think, what I feel, what I hope, what I understand. Oh, what does God's word say? And how do we convey that message to whoever we're teaching? And it says, for we all stumble in many ways. All of us stumble in many ways. If anyone does not stumble in what he says. So that's the key right there, that we're all going to stumble in different ways But if you don't stumble in your words and what you say, then you are mature, able to control the whole body. Why? Because the tongue has power. And James is going to talk about that more. But if you can control what you say and watch how you say it and what you teach, because he's still talking about teachers in this first couple verses, then you can control the whole body if you can control what you say, that you are mature. Not that you're old, okay, but you are mature in your faith and in your knowledge of the and understanding of the Holy Spirit. You have been matured in your faith, able to control the whole body. So not just, so teaching, we should be some diligence there when we teach. When we teach our kids his word, come on. We are called to teach our kids what God's word say. It's not just Sunday teacher's job to teach our kids. We are to teach them through the teaching of God's word, through our actions, through our words, through just sitting down and reading the word together. We are to teach them, and in doing so, man, we got to take time to read it ourselves. I can't teach you something if I don't know what it says. And that applies to all of us in the room. All of us have a kid, a brother, a sister, a grandchild, somebody that we can be teaching through our words, not just our actions, but our words, and taking time to do it, which means we got to be in the word, not just regurgitating something that we've heard from somebody else. Because sometimes they will teach you incorrectly. There is bad doctrine out there, bad teaching. And we want to make sure that we know what God's word says. So when we do hear something like that, we can say, that doesn't sound quite right. I don't want my tongue to just repeat something that's false or something that's not true. So I want to take time to study God's word because I'm going to be held accountable for what I teach. James is telling us that. So we want to take our tongue captive, make sure we know what we're saying, and so we all can be mature, like James says. All right, moving on. Verse 3. Now, if we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us, we direct their whole bodies. And consider ships. Though very large and driven by fierce winds, they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So, too, though the tongue is a small part of the body, it boasts great things. So think about that analogy. How many of you know, been around horses a little bit? I grew up with horses and mules and cows and chickens and all that stuff. But horses are stubborn. Until you put that bit in their mouth and cinch it up around their head and put that lead rope on them, they're not going to go where you want them to go. But the bit, that one little small piece of metal, you put it in their mouth and wrap that thing around their head, they'll follow you. Even if it's not what they want to do at first, eventually, after some training, they'll go where you want them to go. That one little small piece in the mouth, just like the tongue is in the mouth, that little piece of bit in the mouth, you can take that 1,000-pound animal anywhere you want to once you've trained them. Now, it might take some work to get there, but that one little piece, hook on a lead rope to the side of it, you can take them just about anywhere. Same thing with a ship. James gives this analogy. The rudder steers that big piece of boat, metal, wood, whatever the ship is made out of, the rudder controls it. James says, in the same way, our tongue does the same thing. It can steer our body. It can misguide our body. It can take us the wrong direction if our tongue doesn't do what we want it to do. It's small but powerful. Very powerful. And it can boast many things. Here's finishing verse 5. Consider how a small fire sets ablaze a large forest. And the tongue is a fire. The tongue, a world of unrighteousness, is placed among our members. It stains the whole body, sets the course of life on fire, and it is itself set on fire by hell. The tongue is a powerful piece of our body. It can get us into a lot of trouble. It can cause a lot of hurt. James uses the analogy of a forest fire. It doesn't take much to get a fire started. There's an old hymn that says something like, doesn't take much the spark to get a fire going. Now, we've all, and especially here in Alaska, we've seen what a forest fire can do, right? You can lose millions of acres of stuff burnt up to a crisp because of one campfire wasn't put out all the way, or somebody flicking a cigarette out the window, or whatever it is. Can start a whole huge fire. James says that one little piece of tongue can do some damage that's going to be just as big and cause just as much trouble if we don't watch and control our tongue. Now, it can take years of damage to heal. Have been driven up to Anchorage recently and seen the still the remnants of the fires from 2019. It's evident. It's taking years for that stuff to heal. There's some green in the midst of it. There's some flowers. It's healing. But the same thing with our tongue can cause damage that takes years to heal. It may never heal. The damage may be irreparable in some cases, all because of our tongue, because of our words, if we don't watch it. Now, James echoes some testimonies of Proverbs regarding the tongue. I'm going to share a couple of these Proverbs as well. This isn't brand new teaching, but again, remember who James is teaching. He's writing to mostly former Jews who have followed Jesus. So when he shares Proverbs with them, these ring a bell to those that he's writing this letter to, because as Jews and Hebrews, they would have known Proverbs. And so he shares this with them. He's telling them, this is what the tongue can do. If you don't believe me, remember King Solomon? He wrote these words, and here's what some of them say. Proverbs chapter 10, 19 and 21 says, in the multitude of words, sin is not lacking, but he who restrains his lips is wise. The tongue of the righteous is choice silver. The heart of the wicked is worth little. The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for lack of wisdom. Words, his lips, his tongue, all matter and all are very important when it comes to being wise and mature in the faith. New Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25. Anxiety in the heart of man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Good word. Not only does the tongue have the power to destroy, but it has the power to build up, the power to encourage, the power to edify. Proverbs 16:24, pleasant words are like a honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the bones. I maybe just had a terrible day sometime and one person said something really encouraging to you and it changed your whole thought process, your whole day. Man, I hate them kicking rocks down the road. I'm having the worst day ever and somebody says something encouraging, blesses you, and it just changes your whole spirit. Your whole attitude has changed because pleasant words are like honeycomb, sweetness to the soul and health to the bones. It goes back to the tongue and the power that it wields. Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Man, a lot to say that words matter, right? Our tongue matters. And James is teaching us that we have to control it, have to tame it, but it takes work, and it takes maturity, and it takes the Holy Spirit. It takes time. We don't develop overnight as following Jesus and becoming Christ followers that we suddenly decide that, man, everything we speak is a sweet word or a kind word or builds up or encourages. It's a process, just like every other phase of our spiritual discipline. It takes time. It takes spending time in God's word. It takes spending time with other brothers and sisters. We see it. I don't know how many times that people have said something like, or even Natalie, for example, she was telling me a story about when she was at school or at work and at Home Depot, and people were like, I've never heard you curse. She's like, well, I just don't. Like, why? Why does that matter? We'd be more friends if I spoke more vulgar? But that is a spiritual discipline. It comes with time. I don't use those kind of language. I don't use those kind of words. Why? Because Christ is in me. And it's an outlet. We're going to get to that more in James, but look at verse 7. Every kind of animal, bird, reptile, and fish is tamed and has been tamed by humankind. But no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Talked about the horse. You can tame a horse. There's fish out here in this fish tank. You can somewhat tame a fish. There's all these examples. Birds can be tamed, but no one can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. The old adage, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That's not true. Words can hurt. Sometimes I'd rather you chuck a stick at my face than say something really mean because it hurts. The tongue is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Matthew Poole, who's a commentary writer, wrote this. The poison of the tongue is no less deadly It murders men's reputations by the slanders it utters, their souls by the lusts and passions it stirs up in them, and many times their bodies too by the contentions and quarrels it raises up against men. Just think of what words can start. Words can start divorces. Words can start wars. Words can start physical altercations. Words have more power than actions. Actions are usually generated by words, right? Somebody said something you didn't like. I remember one time I got in an argument. Well, actually, I didn't start the argument, which is usually how it works in my life. when I was young, my brother has a big mouth. And I don't care if he watches this because he won't. But if he were to, he would say, yep, he's right, I have a big mouth. And I remember he used to get me in more fights because I was related to him. Not anything I did. Like, I didn't start stuff with people. People didn't. I was usually cool with most people that I hung out with or even people that I just met. My brother loved to start fights with me, with random strangers. Like, he just was like to fight this guy. And that was his mentality. And I remember one time we were at a bar in Tulsa. I was 16. I wasn't even supposed to be in the bar. But when you're 6'4", I guess they just kind of let you in. Don't try that, Matthew. It's not. But we were in a bar, and my brother comes over there to me, and he taps me on the shoulder. He's like, hey, these guys are over here talking trash about you. I said, I don't care. It's fine. And he comes back about 5 minutes later. He goes, no, they're really, man, I try to stop them, but they just won't listen. I'm like, it's fine. Life is cool right now. Just chill out. Next thing I know, my brother brings over this whole group of guys who wants to fight me out of nowhere. And I'm like, what do you want? And so I go back to mind my own business. I feel a tap on my shoulder. I think it's my brother again. So I'm like, what? And this little 5'8" guy punches me as hard as I've ever been punched right in the face. And I got really mad. And so I used to watch a lot of wrestling as a kid. I wasn't a fighter because nobody wanted to fight me. But I used to watch a lot of WWF back in the day. And so my first instinct was powerbomb. And so because I'm 6'4", and he's 5'8", so I grabbed this little guy, and I yank him up like this, and there was a table pretty similar to this, and I threw him on the table. And why am I telling you this story? Because it was the tongue that got me in this trouble. Not my tongue, but my brother's tongue. And these other guys' tongues, apparently. There was a whole lot of trouble because of a tongue that spoke some dumb stuff for no reason. Got me, and then the next thing I know, this guy who was like 6'9", 300-pound guy, grabbed me by the scruff of my neck and just carried me out of the bar. It was the bouncer, and I never felt so little in my life. He snatched me up, and I'm just like, okay, we're going this way. And I did not resist whatsoever because it would have been foolish of me to resist. But anyway, I got thrown out, but the moral of the story is the tongue starts stuff, and usually the body pays the consequence of the tongue. So the body, the heart, the relationships, the soul, the spirit, all these things reap the consequences of what the tongue starts. It's a fire. It's a cancer if it's not tamed. And the only way we can tame it is by Christ in us and the Holy Spirit working in us to make us more like Jesus. Now, he doesn't say it's impossible to tame the tongue. We'll get to that too. But just think of Jesus. Jesus said things that upset people. So it doesn't mean that everything we ever say, everybody's going to be like, oh, that's perfect, that's great. No, Jesus said things that upset people, but when Jesus said things that upset people, it was because he was speaking from what God put in his heart to say. And so maybe it wasn't sweet, covered with honeycomb, but it was truth. And it came from God. It wasn't just, oh, I'm angry, I'm going to flip some tables and do these things and fashion a whip. No, it was a zealous teaching that God gave him to use the tongue in the proper way. It was tamed, but it was still truth. Now, some of you may have heard of John Wesley. He was a theologian in the, I think, mid-1800s. Methodist guy. He and his brother kind of started. His brother wrote most, probably 90% of the hymns you've ever heard of, Charles Wesley. But John Wesley once said he had a woman come to him, and she knew that her talent was, and she told him, I think my talent from God is to speak my mind. Wesley replied, "I don't think God would mind if you buried that talent." Why? Because our tongue gets us in trouble, right? Some people say, "Man, I just want to speak my mind and just say what I want to say. Why can't I just say what I want to say?" Why? Because our tongue gets us in trouble. God put the Holy Spirit to give us a check valve on our lips to say, maybe I don't need to say that. Maybe saying that is a bad idea. Maybe I need to keep that to myself. So James and the writer of Proverbs said, if you can tame your tongue and use sweet words that build up instead of poisonous words that will tear down and destroy, then that's a sign of our maturity and our sanctification of becoming more like Jesus. If we don't, then we've got some maturity to work on. We've got some steps that we still need to take to grow in maturity to be more like Jesus. Verse 9, with the tongue we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in God's likeness. Blessing and cursing come out of the same mouth. My brothers and sisters, these things should not be this way. Does a spring pour out sweet and bitter water from the same opening? He's saying, one moment, man, we're praising the Lord, blessing the Lord, using our tongue and our lips to give God praise because he's an awesome God. The next minute, we're cursing people. He said, it shouldn't be. Can sweetness and bitter come from the same water source? No. If you had a source that was bitter water, you wouldn't use that source. You'd say it's bad. It's contaminated. Don't drink from that. But yet when it comes to our mouth, we'll say, I can do that if I want to. It's fine. There's grace. Amen. There is grace. But there's also maturity and growth and sanctification that should change us to where we don't spew that stuff out of our mouth. That bitterness isn't the fountain that spews out of our soul. It should be blessing, not just cursing. Our speech should be consistently glorifying to God. In public, in private, no matter where we're at, what we're doing, if our words that we're speaking forth don't glorify God, then maybe we've got some work to do. Now, I'm not saying that I am obviously not perfect in this area. None of us are. But we all are growing and becoming more like Jesus, right? Now, if I'm sitting here and I'm banging my head in the car listening to Daniel's music, maybe some of those lyrics don't glorify God. But some of them, maybe they do. He knows the Christian metal bands. I couldn't name one because I never listened to it a day in my life. But if I'm listening to, I don't know, Pantera, which was in my era of heavy metal, Sam's easy, Sam, and I'm singing along with those lyrics, they're probably not sweet and honeycomb and building up, right? Now we get into my genre a little bit more. Maybe if I'm singing along and 50 Cent comes on or Tupac comes on and I'm just flowing with it, I guarantee you not every one of those words edifies and builds up and encourages, right? None of them do. So what he's saying here is I should put that in check. Because anything that comes out of my mouth is not glorifying to God, it's bitter source. It comes from a bad source, and we don't want bitterness and sweetness to come out of the same mouth. It can't come from the same stream. It's our heart. It's a gut check. So maybe I need to change the station. People do that anymore. Skip the track on my playlist. Yeah, man, I push the button on the 8-track and eject that bad boy and put on a different source. Our speech should be, we shouldn't use one vocabulary or tone of speaking at church and a different one at home or at work. Because if that's the case, then something's not right with our words and our tongue. Now, he goes back to the verse that says, does a spring pour out sweet and bitter water from the same opening? James points to this ultimate impossibility of such a contradiction. It is impossible for sweet and bitter to come out of the same source when you put it in the water scenario. It's impossible. It's a contradiction. If bitter water comes from a spring, it's a bad source. Let's go on to verse 12. Can a fig tree produce olives, my brothers and sisters, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a saltwater spring yield fresh water. James is continuing to show us that you cannot have it both ways. If I plant an orange tree and I expect apples, it's not going to happen. No matter how much I hope, no matter how much I water it, prune it, I'm not going to get apples from an orange tree. I'm not going to get sweet words from a contaminated source. I have to use the source that God gave me, which is sweetness, good words, building up, encouraging. Otherwise, we're going to see here soon, James is going to say it could be demonic, which means that I'm not glorifying God, that I have an alternate source in my life that is giving me these words and these desires. I got to put it to death. Otherwise, it's going to have its way in other areas of my life. Now, back to the fruit in the fig tree. Charles Spurgeon said, it would be a monstrosity, a thing to be wondered at and stared at as unnatural and absurd if a fig tree started bearing olive berries. And it's just as unnatural for a Christian to live in sin. Can he so live as to bear the fruits of iniquity instead of the fruits of righteousness? God forbid that it should be. Church, we should be bearing fruit or a good representation of Christ in us. And if our words don't match that, then we're not being good ambassadors of righteousness, ambassadors for Christ, if our words don't match Jesus in us. If our words reflect me, the world, the lyrics that I'm listening to, the shows that I'm watching, whatever I'm taking in through the eyes and the ears, if I'm just regurgitating it outward, then that's not Christ in me. I have something that I need to put to death within me still so that my words are a better example of his word and not of something else that has a grasp on me. I need to put it to death. I need to be more kingdom focused in what I'm doing instead of being so me focused and worldly focused, culture influenced. I need to put it to death. Now, James is going to switch gears here just a little bit in verse 13 and veer away from taming the tongue and talk a little bit more about wisdom and understanding, which will tie us back to what we talked about last week in chapter 2 about good works. But it still has to do with the tongue. We'll still get back to the tongue a little bit. Verse 13, who among you is wise and understanding? By his good conduct, he should show that his works are done in the gentleness that comes from wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast and deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. So we know that James wrote this letter about 10 to 14 years after the resurrection of Christ and after the ascension of Jesus. And this is twice now in these last two chapters where he's alluded to the fact that demons are a real thing. So that closely written to Jesus, probably having heard the stories about Jesus casting out demons and the demon-possessed people, and now he's talking about the things that can be considered demonic if they have a root in your life. Why would we, further away being able to look backwards on what James wrote and everybody else wrote in the Bible, not consider that demons are a real thing? If James wrote about it, James talked about it, other gospel writers talked about it, we should say, yes, demons are a real thing. Because if we don't, we're not acknowledging God's word, first of all, and second of all, we're not acknowledging that there is a spiritual battle that takes place for our soul. Because there is. And the demons like nothing more than us to say that they're not real. To say that, oh, it's just hyperbole, or it's an exaggeration, or it's just your decisions, your life choices. Yes, those are bad things. Decisions and life choices can get us in a bad boat. But so can demonic influence. It's a real thing. And James talks about it. And he says here, who among you is wise and understanding? He's talking about if our wisdom and understanding and good conduct goes back to our works that he talked about last week. But it also plays into our words done in gentleness that come from wisdom. If we're not wise and we don't have wisdom from God's word and it doesn't control our tongue, we're going to have bitter envy, selfish ambition in our heart, and it's going to reflect in our words. If we're angry all the time, bitter, it's going to reflect in how we speak to people. Right? If we have wisdom, good understanding, and good conduct, that's going to be a reflection of how we speak to people. It all ties together in how we speak to one another. But such wisdom does not come down from above. He's talking about the envy and the selfish ambition. We can't have, it's kind of like those two streams again, the salt water and the fresh water. We can't have envy, bitterness, and self-ambition and still be have good conduct and gentleness and wisdom. At some point, there has to be a breakout where this way goes that way and this way goes that way. This way is towards the kingdom of God. This way points to a demonic influence. We can't have both. You can't have it both ways. Look at these three words that James uses for just a moment. Earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. Again, he's talking about the wisdom that is worldly, that creates bitterness, envy, and selfish ambition in our heart. This type of wisdom, these three words, earthly. Earthly wisdom will not help us in the kingdom of God. Earthly wisdom is our words, man's words, something that somebody else taught us, told us. It leads us to selfishness. We hear it all the time. Follow your heart. You do you. Look out for number one. All these types of things is earthly wisdom. It might help you today. It might help you tomorrow a little bit to feel however you want to feel about it, but it's not going to help you in eternity in the kingdom of God. It is not the type of wisdom we want to apply to our lives, and it's not going to help us control the tongue whatsoever. Look at the second one, unspiritual. Some of your translations may say sensual. This means that wisdom comes from the flesh. It's self-satisfying, self-gratifying, completely devoid of a spiritual component. It is almost as if you just unhitched completely from any type of spiritual component and just said, I'm going to do whatever feels right, whatever feels good. It's unspiritual. It's fleshy. And then the last one, he uses the word demonic. This one's pretty self-explanatory, right? You're influenced by demonic influences. You might want to group it into unspiritual, but it's different. Demonic is certainly spiritual. It's just the wrong kind of spiritual. Demons fall into their own spiritual category, but it's still spiritual, right? They exist. They're real. They're under the influence of Satan, but it's still spiritual. And if we're following this type of demonic influence in our wisdom, man, we got bigger issues than just our tongue saying some mean things. We have a bigger issue in that I am headed down a road that's not only taking me straight to hell, but I'm trying to take other people with me as much as I can because I don't want to go by myself. And so my demonic influence is going to be like, hey, why are you going to that stupid church in the mall? Or why are you doing this? Or why are you praying to Jesus? And all these things that are demonic influence that try to point away from Christ and point. People don't want to go to hell by themselves. They want to take you with them. They're going to tell you whatever they can to have you walk down that, skipping down this path straight to hell with them. They don't want to go alone. So it's poor wisdom. It's bad wisdom. And James calls it demonic. It's real. Verse 16. We're going to wrap up chapter 3 here. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there is disorder and every evil practice. Still talking about evil practices, still falling under that category. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peace-loving, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. Man. I love verse 17. Wouldn't that be great to have those words used towards you and your tongue? You and your mouth, you and your words, you and how you carry yourself, how you build up and equip others. Oh, yeah, man, that's great wisdom that guy has. Man, it's pure, it's peace-loving, it's gentle, it's compliant, it's full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering without pretense. That's good wisdom. That's the only kind of wisdom that we can apply from God's word. If we read his word, if we're in it, we ask the Lord to give us discernment, understanding. This is going to be the fruit of that. It's going to be gentleness. It's going to be full of mercy, good fruit, unwavering. It's the type of work that God does in us. He cultivates our heart. And before you know it, man, we're not spitting out that bitterness, envy, selfish ambition. words that don't encourage or don't that don't build up, we start to lose that Sunday morning talk, and it, or that talk that doesn't jive on Thursday that we see on Sunday. We don't have two different vocabularies for ourselves anymore. We don't have our workday talk and our Sunday morning talk. It all just kind of starts to bleed into Sunday morning. It all starts to be a better reflection of Christ in us, in equipping and encouraging and edifying the saints around us. And I love it that he says, and the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. What a great word or somebody could call you is, hey, that Daniel, man, he's a cultivator of peace. Wow, thanks a lot. That's a great encouragement. But I can't get that way if I don't have Christ in me, because the Christ is peace. He is understanding, and he cultivates that peace in us to where we too can be a cultivator of peace in our homes, in our relationships, in our workplace. Have you ever worked somewhere that wasn't peaceful? I have. But just think, if you could go into that workplace and you'd be the cultivator of peace because of your tongue, and you've learned to tame it, and you've learned to live out Christ in you, and you could be the one person that says, man, it sure feels awkward in here today. Oh, that's because Karina's not here today. If Karina was here, boy, it'd be a cultivator of peace among us. I'm just picking on Karina because she cultivates peace. But don't we want to be known as somebody who cultivates peace? Not known as somebody who is selfish, ambition, envy, bitterness, who can't control their tongue, whose words destroy and tear down? Or we'd rather be the person who builds up, encourages, and cultivates peace. We can, but we have to let God work in us. We have to hide his word in our heart. We have to ask him for discernment. We have to ask him for wisdom and understanding so that we can be changed to be more like Jesus. So we can tame the tongue. So we can let the Holy Spirit of Almighty God be that bit in our horse's mouth and take us where we need to go. When we want to be stubborn, the Holy Spirit grabs us by that reins and says, nope, this way, brother. You're going the wrong way. You're being too loud. You're yapping again. You need to come over here and be quiet for a little while. Be still. Horse, drink this water. Be quiet. Calm down for a little bit. Let God's Spirit teach us, discern for us, and sometimes yank us with our loud mouth and be calm and peaceful and be cultivators of peace. And we're going to finish with a couple of ways that we can control the tongue. And then here's the question, do you control your tongue or does it control you? That's a hard one to wrestle with. But here's some ways that we can control our tongue. Number one, consider the impact of your words. How many times when you're in a heated argument or you got something, you just really want to say it, did you really stop and say, well, let me consider the impact of these words before I say it? I bet if we did, we might say less harmful things to each other. Because sometimes, man, we're just waiting. We just want to throw that knockout punch. We're like, I'm ready. And when you stop yapping, I've got it ready for you. But what if we just considered the impact of our words? Number two, ask yourself, do my words build up or do they tear down? It's a way that we can help control our tongue. Man, what I want to say, I'm not going to say it because it doesn't build up. And I need to be a person who builds up instead of destroys and tears down. Number three, take every thought captive before you speak. Scripture tells us in 2 Corinthians 10:5, and every proud thing that is raised up against the knowledge of God, and we take every thought captive to obey Christ. If we could take every thought captive before we say it out loud, man, that'll help us control the tongue before we speak. And then lastly, just like we talked about last week, we be kingdom focused in everything we say. Now, that might just seem like a lazy tie-in to throw it in there because we're in this kingdom focused thing. But listen, everything we do can be done through the lens of the kingdom of God. Our words, how we serve, our actions, our works, we talked about it last week, if our works should be kingdom focused. Our works and our words can be kingdom focused. It should be spirit led. full of salt, right? We want to preserve. We want to make things taste better. We want it to be a building up and encouraging. If I can be kingdom focused in everything I say or do, then man, I could be able to control my tongue. At least better, right? Because the only way we can truly control our tongue is Christ in us, changing us and making us more like him. That's called sanctification. It's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. It's a process. It's like Paul talks about that daily dying to self and putting on Jesus every day. If I'm putting on Jesus every day and dying to myself every day, then I'm going to become more like Jesus. That's how the process works. I can't hold on to this and say, man, I really don't want to put this piece to death because I really love it. I want to put on a little bit of Jesus. But then on Tuesday morning, I'm shedding off Jesus and I'm putting on full me and I'm coming on full attack mode with my words because that's how I get stuff done. I guarantee you, if you leave on that righteousness of Jesus and you die to yourself every day, you're going to get stuff done. But you're going to do it with better words as a cultivator of peace. And you're going to be kingdom focused in everything we say or do as we become more and more like Jesus. We're never going to be exactly like Jesus because he's the Son of God, but he set the precedent and he gave us all the things that we need to do to become more like him. He showed us through love, through grace, through mercy, through forgiveness, all these things that we need to be like Jesus, but we can't do it if we're apart from Jesus. You can't look at Jesus from afar and say, man, I want to be like Jesus, but if Jesus is here and he's in me and he's growing me to be more and more like him, I can become more like Jesus. He has to be in me, working in me. Let's pray. God, thank you for this time this morning to be in your word. Thank you for James chapter 3. And Lord, I love the examples of how the tongue can destroy. How it can be like a wildfire. How it's like a ship's rudder. How it can steer us into trouble. How it's so small yet powerful, just like the bit in a horse. Lord, help us to let your Holy Spirit guide us to be that rudder that steers us towards righteousness, to be that bit in our mouth to help us to avoid confrontation with mean words and hateful things. God, give us your spirit to be a cultivator of peace, to control our words, to tame our tongue, and to speak life wherever we go, to be an encourager, to be an equipper, and to just love the way that you love, Lord. And when it's time to be truthful, to use our tongue to speak truth as well, but to speak truth in love. So, Lord, we give you our hearts this morning. God, if there's anyone today who doesn't quite know you, is still looking at Jesus from afar and saying, man, I'd like to be like him. God, I pray today you put it on their heart to know you as Lord and Savior, to surrender to the only one who can, and that's Jesus. So this morning, if that's you, just surrender it all. Just say, Jesus, I need you. I need you to be Lord and Master of my life. And if you already know him, praise the Lord. We're thankful for Jesus this morning. Father, we give you this time right now. As we sing this last song, Father, put it on our hearts. Put it on our lips to speak praise, to sing praise this morning. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing this morning, church. Yeah. Thank you, worship team. It's so cool seeing all you young people up here using your gifts and talents to give God praise. Thank you, guys. That was good this morning. Awesome. Again, tonight, no potluck tonight, but we will have it next week at 5:30. Dan, you have something about hiking? Awesome. All right, church. That's all I've got, too, for today. Dave Klein, will you pray for us, brother?